الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد إن شاء الله تعالى today we're gonna do our last book in the Dawrah Ilmiyyah ama Dawrah Ta'siliyah that we had. Inshallah ta'ala, the book that we're going to be doing today is called Ad-Durar al-Bahiyyah fi al-Masail al-Fiqhiyyah. The kitab is written by a great scholar, Muhammad ibn Ali al-Shawkani rahimahullah. After I was asked excessively from different brothers and also received different emails, I made the decision, inshallah ta'ala, to do Kitab al-Tahara today and tomorrow Kitab al-Salah. So everyone gets what they want, inshallah ta'ala. The Kitab, inshallah, is called Ad-Durar al-Bahiyyah. The book is called Ad-Durar al-Bahiyyah. And the name Ad-Durar is Jam'u Durrah. The word Durar is plural. And it's a broken plural. And the singular is Durrah. And the word Durrah, هي اللؤلؤ العظيمة الباهرة. It is a jewel. And البهية means الحسنة الجميلة. So, a beautiful jewel. The author named it. And this is to make the person appreciate knowledge. And the scholars, as you can see, this is what they saw. Knowledge of the religion, like a jewel, a pearl. That's how they looked at it, a beautiful pearl. The author of this book is Abu Abdullah Muhammad ibn Ali al-Shawkani rahimahullah. Thumma al-Sana'ani. Min ulama al-Yemen. Imam al-Shawkani from the scholars of Yemen. And he was born the year 1172 Hijriya, and he died 1250 Hijriya, and he's considered to be from the Fuqaha al-Muhaditheen. He's from the people combined between the knowledge of Hadith and also the knowledge of Fiqh. He has many books, Al-Imam al-Shawkani rahimahullah, has many books. From his books is this book that we have with us, which is called Ad-Durar al-Bahiyyah, which he himself explained the book. He called it Ad-Durar al-Bahiyyah. He explained his own book. And also, it was explained by the great Imam from India, Siddiq Hasan Khan as well. Siddiq Hasan Khan explained it in a kitab which he called it Ar-Rawdha al-Nadiyyah fi Sharh Durar al-Bahiyyah, something like that. And the beauty of that kitab, the Rawd of Sadiq Hassan Khan, Sheikh Al-Albani rahimahullah taught it whilst in Sham. And what Sheikh Al-Albani did was he graded and he authenticated the ahadiths in there. So it turned out to be two volumes. So you can find the book itself with the sharah of Sadiq Hassan Khan, Durar al-Bahiyyah, the sharah of Siddiq Hasan Khan, and also the takhrij al-hadith of Sheikh Al-Albani rahimahullah. So this gives the book great value. One of his books that he also wrote is Nailul Awtar. Shawkani wrote a kitab called Nailul Awtar. And this kitab, Nailul Awtar, is a sharah of a kitab called Muntaqal Akhbar. And this kitab, Muntaqal Akhbar, is a kitab written by Jaddu Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah. Ibn Taymiyyah's granddad, Abdul Salam. Ibn Taymiyyah's name is what? Ahmed ibn Abdul Halim ibn Abdul Salam. Abdul Salam, he wrote a book called Muntaqal Akhbar. Muntaqal Akhbar is a book in Ahadith al-Ahkam. It's like Bulugh al-Maram. Okay, it's bigger than Bulugh al-Maram. But it's like it. It's Ahadith al-Ahkam. So Shawkani came and he explained it. It's rather one of the best explanations. In there, you can see the fiqh of this man and his knowledge of fiqh and his knowledge of hadith. Siddiq Hassan al-Shawkani rahimahullah. So many scholars, they quote from that book, Nail al-Awtar by Shawkani. Inshallah ta'ala, this book is big. To explain it all in details, there's many things in there that can be taken out, and Misa'il Fiqhiyya. But because it's Dawrah Ilmiyyah, we don't have much time to go through deep fiqhi issues. But what we will do, inshallah ta'ala, is we will touch on a lot of issues here and there. So if there's an issue that I haven't given it justice, it's because of the time. We can't go through all of these issues in great details. Na'am.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم كتاب الطهارة باب المياه الماء طاهر مطهر ولا يخرجه عن الوصفين إلا ما غير ريحه أو لونه أو طعمه من النجاسات.
The author رحمه الله, he started his kitab with كتاب الطهارة. What does طهارة mean لغة? What does the طهارة mean in the Arabic language? It means النزاهة والنظافة من الأدناس والأوساخ. The word at-tahara, it means an-nazaha, wal-nazafa. It is to purify from yourself. It is to clean from yourself any impurities. That's what it means in the language. It means an-nazafa, to clean from yourself. Or an-nazaha, to protect from yourself any impurities. That's what it means in the Arabic language. The اصطلاح usage, the technical usage of the word tahara is رفع الحدث. It is to remove hadith. We'll mention what hadith is. Okay? رفع الحدث, to remove hadith. And al-hadith, it is الطهارة بالوضوء والغسل. It is to purify yourself. Hadith is what either necessitates wudu or it necessitates showering. That's what hadith is. وزوال الخبث. So tahara is what? رفع الحدث وزوال الخبث. And it's also to remove khabath. So the second thing is tahara, زوال الخبث. What does khabath mean? Khabath means cleaning either from your body or your clothing or from a place, an impurity that can be seen. Any impurity that goes on your body or on your clothing or on the place that you want to pray, it's called a what? Khabath. Khabath. Dahara means to remove that as well. Like in hadath, there's nothing you can touch. It's a person who had sexual intercourse. Even if he showered 20 times, if he hasn't come with the intention of removing this impurity from himself, in the sharia, he still has hadath. Are we all together? Like in the khabath, you don't even need intention for it. Are we all together, brothers? If urine goes on your clothes, you don't have to come with intention to remove this impurity. If you just pour water over it and it cleans it, it's enough. Or urine goes onto the place you want to pray on and you wash it. Or your body, urine goes on it and you wash it. It doesn't require intention. Okay? That's the difference. Like in hadith, it's not about cleanliness. It's not about clean. It's something which is غير محسوس. It's something you can't touch. Are we all together, brothers? I'll give you an example. A person passes wind, or even urinates, and he goes to the toilet and he washes himself from his private part. He washes his genital, he washes his private part, and then he goes into the bath and he showers, and he comes out. Is he clean in the sharia? Yeah? He's clean. He's clean to the people. Lakin in the Sharia, there's still hadith on him. Because he needs to do what? For the salah. Al-wudu. This man did something bigger than wudu. What did he do? He showered, I said. He's fully clean. Hadith. Wudu is needed. It's about how clean you are and how much you wash yourself. Are we all together? Lakin najasa is when there's impurity on you. If you wash that impurity off, then fine. Are we all together? So tahara is those two. Also tahara is وَمَا فِي مَعْنَاهُ, that which is in its meaning. Why do we say وَمَا فِي مَعْنَاهُ? The third thing it can also be is, let's say a person has wudu. This is a qadiyah that many people get hidden from. Someone has wudu and he wants to do another wudu. Can he say, I'm doing tahara? He's got wudu. He can just pray if he wants to. But he wants to renew his wudu again. He wants to do another wudu. He likes to do wudu for every salah. Is this called a tahara? It's called a tahara. For Sharia, he's doing what? A tahara. Are we all together, brothers? So even that though, he's not stopped from praying. He wants to just do wudu. Tajdeedul wudu. For Sharia, it's still called tahara. Still called what? Tahara. Here, brothers, the author started the book by saying Kitab al-Tahara. The word Kitab comes from the root word Kataba, Yaktubu, Kitabatan, wa Kitaban. And this word Kitab, it means al-jam'u wa dhammu, when things come together. Walidharika, in the battlefield, they call it Katibatul Jaysh, Jama'atul Jaysh, a group of people. Katiba means kitab, all of those. And that's why the reason why it's called a katiba is because it's a majmu'atu min afradi al-jaysh. It's a number of... So why is it called kitab al-tahara? We know what tahara means, kitab. Kitab, under it, there is a number of babs. And under the babs, there are fusul. And under the fusul, there are masail. And that's how you write a book. You write a kitab. And in that kitab, there are bab, which kitab al-tahara, what bab is it that he's going to start with? Bab al-miyah, water. Are we all together? Now we've understood that. The tahara is two types. The tahara is also two types. When we look at it, where it comes from, where it happens, the tahara, بِاعْتِبَارِ مَحَلِّهَا, we're looking at it from the place it happens from. It's two types. The first one is طَهَارَةُ الْبَدَنِ, the purity of the body. طَهَارَةُ الْبَدَنِ, the purity of the body. And that's the one that we're talking about here, where we're saying رَفْعُ الْحَدَثِ وَإِزَالَةِ النَّجَاسَةِ, it's to remove the hadath and the najasa from ourselves. This is طَهَارَةُ الْبَدَنِ, it's a physical purity. There's a second one, which is taharatu al-batina. Tahara, which is batina. Inna tahara. And this is taharatu min ash-shirki. It is a purification from shirk. Wal-ghilli wal-baghda'i wal-hasad. Having enmity in your heart to the believers. Associating partners with Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. And that's the one Allah tabarak wa ta'ala said in the Quran, innama al-mushrikuna najas. The first najasa that the disbelievers have is shirk. Are we all together? And some of the scholars, they said that in the hadith of the Prophet where he said, "Inna al-mu'mina la yanjus," that the believer, he doesn't become impure. The Prophet means, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, at-taharatul batina, the inner tahara. The believer doesn't lose that. Are we all together? "Inna al-mu'mina la yanjus," rawahu al-Bukhari wa Muslim. Bukhari and Muslim both narrated that. Now when we look at tahara bi'tibari naw'iha, when we look at tahara in terms of its types, okay, it's two types, major and minor. Major and minor. The major one, as you can see, brothers, is the tahara which is called taharatul kubra, a major tahara, and a minor tahara which is called taharatul sughra. The tahara which is kubra, wa huwa al-ghuslu, is what brings about ghusl. You have to shower. That's the major impurity. It brings about ghusl. And the tahara to sughra, it brings about what? Al-wudu. These two that I just mentioned, which is taharatul kubra and taharatul sughra, applies on raf'ul hadath, when you're removing the hadath. Are we all together? The removing of the hadath is these two types, al-kubra and al-sughra. Lakin izalatul najas, ama izalatul khabath, is three types. To remove filth, it's three types. Okay, it is ghaslin, to wash. Sometimes you're going to need to wash the place that the impurity went onto. So, and the second one is mashin. You just have to wipe it. And the third one is nadhin. You just have to sprinkle water on it. Ibn Rushdin mentions this in his Bidayat al-Mujtahid. It's called nadhin. It's to sprinkle water. The asal of the tahara, brothers, is al-ma, water. The water is the asal. And the tayammum is when the water is absent. Okay? And there is no water. Or you're unable to use the water for one reason or another. So that's why the scholars, when they speak about tahara, first thing they mention is al-ma. Because all of the tahara goes back to water. That's the asal. So we start with al-ma. The scholars, they divided amongst themselves, ahlul ilm, اختلفوا فيما بينهم على أقوال أقواها قولان. Like two views are the strongest. That the water, how many types are there? How many types of water are there? We spoke about kitab al-tahara. Now we're going to bab al-miyah. The scholars, ahlul ilm, فِيمَا بَيْنَهُمْ, between themselves, they differed in the types of water there are. أَقْوَال عَدِيدًا. If you look at books of fiqh, it's so much. لَكِنْ أَقْوَاهَا قَوْلًا. Two views are the strongest that are worth mentioning. The first view is أَنَّ الْمَاء ثَلَاثَةُ أَقْسَامٍ. That the water is أَنَّ الْمَاء ثَلَاثَةُ أَقْسَامٍ. That the water is three types. طَهُورٌ وَطَاهِرٌ وَنَجَسٌ. So they divided the water into three. طَهُورٌ وَطَاهِرٌ وَنَجَسٌ. Are we all together, brothers? We'll speak about all of that inshallah soon. طَهُورٌ and طَاهِرٌ and نَجَسٌ is a categorization done by the four مَذَاهِبُ الْفِقِيَّةِ الْأَرْبَعَةِ. The four followed madhabs, and Imam Abu Hanifa, and Imam Malik, and Imam Shafi'i, and Imam Ahmad, their madhabs, four of them, unanimously agree these three types. There's another view, which is that the water is only categorized into two, that it's either tahur or najas. The water is either tahur or najas. And this is the view of بعض الحنفية واختيار شيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية وابن باز وابن عثيمين. This is a view held by some of the حنفية, the أحناف, and it's a view pushed by شيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية and also ابن باز and شيخ ابن عثيمين رحمه الله. Rather, this قول can be said وهو قول المحققين من أهل العلم. Scholars who do tahqiq of masail, this is the view that they've taken. Are we all together? So now we're going to go, inshallah ta'ala, into that, bi'idhni illahi al-kareem. The author, rahimahullah, he said, al-ma'u, the water, tahirun, it is pure, mutahhirun. Here we have a water which is pure, and it purifies. The water, brothers, that is tahir, is laysa binajasin. In and within itself, this water is not impure. Mutahirun means, it means it purifies others. There's two characteristics that the water has. The water itself is pure. And also it purifies other things. And when we say it purifies other things, we mean it removes what? Hadath and izalatul najas. Izalatul khabath. Those two things. And these are the unrestricted water. When we just say water, generally it's what? It is tahir and it's also mutahir. And that is what Allah said in the Quran, وَأَنزَلْنَا مِنَ السَّمَاءِ مَاءً طَهُورًا. We sent down from the sky a pure water. That's what the Prophet said. The man who urinated in the masjid. جَاءَ عَرَابِيٌ فَبَالَ فِي طَائِفَةِ الْمَسْجِدِ فَزَجَرَهُ النَّاسِ. A man came and he urinated in the side of the masjid. A Bedouin man. The people scolded him. What did they do? They scolded him and they told him off. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to them, "Da'uhu, leave him." And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he commanded for what? He said, "Ahriquhu alaihi dhanuba mimma." Go, take a bucket of water and pour it over. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Mimma, water, unrestricted. There's no quyud connected to that water. It's not called ma'ul ward, ma' this or ma' that. Just water, pure water. Go and pour it." On there. And then the water, what is it? It pure in and within itself, and it can also purify based on the hadith of the Bedouin man. The author then said, لا يخرج عن الوصفين. Nothing can remove the water from these two ascriptions. What are the two ascriptions? That it being tahir in and within itself and purifying other things, nothing can take those two from it, those two descriptions. Unless the following happens to it. The water, it's dahir and it's also mutahir until one of these happens to it. إِلَّا مَا غَيَّرَ رِيحَهُ أَوْ لَوْنَهُ أَوْ طَعْمَهُ مِنَ النَّجَاسَاتِ. It is that which changes its rihahu, its smell. أَوْ لَوْنَهُ, its color. أو طعمه, its taste. من النجاسات, because of what? Because of impurities that fell into it. Now this water no longer can do what? رفع الحدث وإزالة النجاسة. This water cannot remove حدث and it also cannot remove نجاسة. What's the evidence that the water is tahir and mutahir? وَأَنزَلْنَا مِنَ السَّمَاءِ مَاءً طَهُورًا وَيُنَزِّلُ عَلَيْكُم مِنَ السَّمَاءِ مَاءً لِيُطَهِرَكُم بِهِ. And the story of the Bedouin man that I mentioned. And also the ayah, فَلَمْ تَجِدُوا مَاءً فَتَيَمَّمُوا صَعِيدًا. So Allah تبارك وتعالى said, if you can't find water, and the water is pure in and within itself, and it also what? It purifies. What is it that can remove the purity of that water and get rid of its purity? It is rihahu, its smell. The scent that comes from the water. أو لونه, the color. أو طعمه, its taste. من النجاسات, because of impurities that fall into it. Some scholars, they transmitted consensus on these three. Are we all together, brothers? Some scholars, they transmitted what? Consensus, ijma'. Ibn al-Mundhir rahimahullah, he brought an ijma'. He said, وَأَجْمَعُوا عَلَى أَنَّ الْمَاءَ الْقَلِيلَ وَالْكَثِيرَ إِذَا وَقَعَتْ فِيهِ نَجَاسَةً فَغَيَّرَ لِلْمَاءِ طَعْمًا أَوْ لَوْنًا أَوْ رِيحًا أَنَّهُ نَجَسٌ مَا دَامَ كَذَلِكَ. If a water, whether it's little or a lot, if an impurity falls into it, and it then changes that water, it changes its what? Its taste. And it also changes its fragrance, the scent, or it changes the color, then this water will be considered what? Impure water. The ahadiths that have come, they are not authentic. So the famous hadith, إِنَّ الْمَاءَ لَا يُنَجِسُهُ شَيْءٍ إِلَّا مَا غَلَبَ عَلَى رِيحِهِ وَطَعْمِهِ وَلَوْنِهِ. Then this hadith, أخرجه ابن ماجه والدار القطني والبيهقي في سنن الكبرى وهو حديث ضعيف من حديث أبي أمامة الباهلي. And also Ibn Hajar brings it in كتاب باب المياه. He brings it in كتاب الطهارة. So that hadith is ضعيف. لكن الإجماع is the evidence here. The water can have two things that fall into it. A water, two things can fall in it or can go into it. It can be something which is what? Impure, which is najas. If something impure goes into the water, then it changes the smell, or it changes the taste, or the color. This water is impure. It's not pure in and within itself, nor can it purify. But if something pure falls into the water, like you put a tea bag inside a water, then this is considered pure. It's tahir, but it's not mutahir. It is pure in and within itself, but it can't purify. So you can't use that water to do wudu with it, and you can't do ghusl with it. That's why the author, rahimahullah, here, he said, أَوْ طَعْمَهُ مِنَ النَّجَاسَاتِ, that what falls into it is an impure thing. But if something pure falls in it and changes the taste, or it changes the color, or it changes the scent and the fragrance, this doesn't make it what? It doesn't make it ma, which is najas. The water is tahir, but it's not mutahir.